Post-war consensus in British politics. Post-war consensus. In order for us to agree on whether or not there was indeed a consensus, we must first define what do we mean by consensus. So let the definition be: a political consensus is an imaginary instrument that minimizes the incentives for governments to change major policies. Right. With such a definition, seldom will find consensus to have existed in public ownership. So what he means by that is that during the 30s the Conservatives increased the public ownership, and this is for Selden the establishment of the post-war consensus. According to Selden, actually, if we didn't have the coalition governments from 1915 to 21 and from 31 to 40, we would have seen a consensus much earlier. Right, if we move on to the next person, it could be Fraser's idea that we had a shift in the median voter. That is to say that it wasn't a government that caused the consensus, but rather the people, the electorate, right? Another view is that is the one by Candia, who argues that it was the economic situation. Economic situation in Britain after World War II that forced the policymakers into the policies that later formed the consensus. So Candia speaks of you could call it a forced consensus rather than an ideologic consensus. He shows that the Labour Party still had the socialistic view, and the Conservatives had their neoliberal ideas throughout the period with the so-called consensus. If we move on, we have historians just such as Jefferies, who believed that the consensus was established by the Attlee government in 45. So that is based on Beveridge report. So they increased the welfare state. They started to implement Keynesianism, which we saw throughout the period. The last view I'll point to is the one by Knight, who argues that the consensus did exist and it was established by the Conservatives in 51. Right, so that is, one could argue that in order for a consensus to be evident, you have to show that neither the Labour Party or the Conservatives will want to change the policies dramatically. And that cannot have been seen until you've had both a Labour Party and a Conservative government. Other historians, such as Pimlott, argues that there didn't even exist a consensus, right? It's an idea made up by historians later on. So it again comes down to this definition. How do we define consensus? if we define it as a binding agreement between policymakers and the Labour Party and the Conservatives, clearly that didn't exist. There was no such agreement. But if we define it more broadly, as we've done in this video, some fields of politics definitely have a consensus. That includes the public ownership explained by Selden. It includes Keynesianism, the welfare state, and perhaps most importantly, when it comes to defence policies, as argued by Knight, the consensus regarding those actually continued to exist from World War II and throughout the Thatcher government, which has been set to have ended the other part of politics that had a consensus. So she went away from Keynesianism, she went away from this protection of domestic industries and promoted competitiveness. But the defence policies remain. So especially when it comes to those, there did indeed exist a consensus.